Welcome to the video lecture series on sociology based on class 11 textbook that is Introducing Society. In this lecture, we'll be discussing two concepts from chapter 1, that is sociology and society. These concepts are the sociological imagination and pluralities and inequalities in society. But before we move on to these concepts, let's take an example. The example from your own life, you might be getting a lot of suggestions. And the first suggestion which you might be getting very often is that study hard and you'll do well in life. Now take another suggestion which you as a student might be getting very often, and that is that if you select this subject or a set of subject, you'll get a better job in future. Now come on to the third suggestion. If you're a boy, if you take a subject, I mean the people might ask you, do you think it's a good subject for you? Or as a girl, if you identify a subject for yourself, the people might ask, do you think it's a practical subject? Now another suggestion which you students might be receiving and might have received very often is that, you know, you have to work early. So why do you take a subject, you know, which takes you longer to finish your studies? And another thing is that the suggestion which might come to you is that, you know, you are into family business, you have a family business, so why do you have to study again? Now these are the set of suggestions which you, a class 11 student, might you know, come across, or you might have actually listened to many a times. Let us analyze these suggestions. Do you think that the first suggestion contradicts the other three? The first suggestion says that if you work hard, you'll do well in life. Here, the onus rests upon an individual. But the second suggestion says that apart from individual effort, there is a job market which decides the kind of subject which you are choosing, whether you'll be able to do well with those subjects in life or not, whether you'll get a good job or not. Now the third and fourth suggestions actually complicates the issue, which says that apart from your own individual efforts and the job market, there is a gender and there is a family background which also matters. Individual efforts matter a great deal, but they do not necessarily define outcome. If we talk about job market, it is defined by the economy. And if we talk about the needs of economy, these are determined by the political and economy measures of the government. Now, the success of a student not only depends upon his own individual effort, it depends upon these broader issues like the political and economic measures, as well as his own social background. So this is what sociology studies. It studies society as an interconnected whole. It studies the relationship, the interaction between society and an individual. The problem of choosing a subject is an individual personal problem, but it also affects students in a collective manner. Then it becomes a public issue. And now we come on to the first concept, that is sociological imagination, and this is what it talks about. This is the term coined by C. Wright Mills in 1959. He is a very famous American sociologist, and he talked about two very important things in sociological imagination. The one thing is there is no personal problem, you know, most of the things are public issue. Now let's take that example again when we talked about, you know, the taking of a subject and selecting a subject. Now when you take a subject and when you decide that you have to take one particular subject, and if you're the only one who's got this problem, then yes, it's a personal problem. But if we have around 500 or 1,000 students who face the same thing, then it becomes a public issue. This is what he talks about, and he says that there is a distinction between the personal problem and the public issue. He says that the personal trouble occurs within the character of an individual, and the public issue is, you know, when these matters transcends beyond the local environment, they become the public issue. Now he gave a lot of examples, you know, he gave example in his book The Sociological Imagination. He talked about, you know, unemployment, he talked about, you know, war, he talked about marriage, he talked about living in a metropolis. Let us take an example of unemployment in detail. He says very clearly, you know, if a person is unemployed, so many a times it happens that the society says, or people, you know, who are at the authority, they say that the person is unemployed because he's not willing to work. He's a lazy person. He doesn't have the required skill. But this is not so. If it is one person, yes. But if we are talking about 1% of a population, then it becomes a public issue. Now, when we say that public issue, so where is the problem? The problem lies in the mismanagement of the society. So here, these are the issues which the sociologists need to study. The second very important thing which C. Wright Mills talked about is the sociological imagination is a quality of mind which allows one to grasp history and biography and their relationship between the two within the society. Now, if we have to study any natural phenomena, anything at present moment, we have to study the past also. Because if something happens in present, there is lot involved in, you know, making of that particular thing, in the existence of that particular thing, and that might have happened in the past. So if we are talking about the sociological study, and if we have to study any phenomena, we have to study the present also, like the present being of that particular thing, and the past also, because there could be many social, economic, political factors that have shaped that particular thing into what it is right now. And another thing is that he also says that the sociological imagination is quality of mind that helps us use information and develop reason to make sense of what is going on in the society and how it is affecting us. Now let's come to the second theme, which is pluralities and inequalities in society. Now when we talk about pluralities and inequalities in society, here also I would like to take that example again. You know, in the first example, we talked about that if you take this particular subject or a set of subject, you'll get a good job. Now, what is a good job? Is it something which gives you a lot of money? Is it something which gives you a lot of satisfaction? Is it something which actually increases your self-esteem? So what exactly is a good job? Or is it something which is, you know, good for your own relevant society? Now, what is relevant society? You might be thinking, the society to which we belong. And another question which might come to our mind is, which is the society we belong to? Is it a one particular linguistic group, ethnic group? Like if we are in amongst foreigners, we may say that we belong to Indian society, right? But if we are with our Indian fellows, we might say that I belong to this caste, I belong to this community, I belong to, you know, this particular language group. So the society is different and there is lot of diversity. Now this plurality and diversity of society in India offers lot of challenges for the sociologist. Now this diversity makes the work difficult for sociologist, and this also makes work difficult for not only sociologist but for the other people as well. Now, we'll take a look at, you know, what Satyajit Ray, a noted filmmaker, said when he was actually trying to decide, you know, what to depict in a one particular society. It's there in your textbook, and he wrote it very beautifully. And he actually took three different situations and three different focal point in societies, and he was actually mulling over what to project in his films. What he said was, what should you put in your films? What can you leave out? Would you leave the city behind and go to village where cows graze in endless fields and the shepherd plays the flute? You can make a film here that would be pure and fresh and have the delicate rhythm of a boatman's song. Or would you rather go back in time way, back to the epics, where the gods and demons took sides in the great battle where brothers killed brothers? Or would you rather stay where you are, right in the present, in the heart of this monstrous, teeming, bewildering city, and try to orchestrate its dizzying contrast of sight and sound and milieu? Now, this is what he was actually going through. But then there's another question, what to focus in a society? See, when Satyajit Ray talked about village, he actually romanticized village. Now let's listen to what a sociologist had to say about a village life. The first time I saw him, he was sitting on the dusty road in front of one of the small thatch-roofed tea shops in the village with his glass and saucer. Placed conspicuously beside him, a silent signal to the shopkeeper that an untouchable wanted to buy some tea. Muli was a gaunt 40-year-old with beetle-blackened teeth who wore his long hair swept back. Now these are the two very contrast representation of Indian village. Now as a sociologist, it is very important to find out which one to portray. And inequality is also a one important thing, and it says that it's central to any society. Amartya Sen, Nobel laureate, he got a Nobel Prize for economics in 1998, and he also wrote very beautifully what sociology should do and what are the different things which we should project in society. And in his book, The Argumentative Indian, he wrote very beautifully, some Indians are rich, most are not. Some are very well educated, others are illiterate. Some lead easy lives of luxury, others toil hard for little reward. Some are politically powerful, others cannot influence anything. Some have great opportunities for advancement in life, others lack them altogether. Some are treated with respect by the police, others are treated like dirt. These are different kinds of inequality, and each of them requires serious attention. So if we talk about sociology and if we talk about work of sociologists, like we have to look at, you know, all these inequalities which exist in the society. Now, when we talk about sociology, you have a textbook and there is a lot written in the textbook, but you have to go beyond your textbook also. The number of people who have written very good books on, you know, the society and the social phenomena, and we would suggest that you also read those books whenever you get time. So there are three books which I would recommend you, two which we have already talked about. One is The Sociological Imagination by C. Wright Mills, and the other one is The Argumentative Indian by Amartya Sen. And the third book is a very interesting book. It is Tuesdays with Maury, and this book is about a sociology professor and how he gave, you know, the different sociology lesson to his students. And it's a very light, but it's a very interesting reading material, and you would definitely love this. When we talk about sociology, as I said, that there's a lot written in the textbook, but you have your own knowledge, because here we are talking about society, and as a student, you also might be observing a lot. So keep observing and keep sharing. We have actually created a Google group for you wherein you can post your queries also related to this particular discipline. And if you have any observation which you would like to share with the sociologists in the country, and if you like to initiate any debate on any of the issue, so you can post in that particular group. This is all for the day, and keep observing and keep learning. Thank you.